As part of my quest to build my ultimate flashlight, I've designed an LED boost driver dev board. In the previous video, we covered the configuration of basic functions like the UVLO, the output voltage, and the current setpoint potential divider. In this video, we'll be continuing our journey through the rest of the circuit, starting with why we need two current sense resistors. Let's switch over to the oscilloscope to see how the brightness of the LED is controlled by the DAC. The LED voltage, and therefore current, looks proportional to the DAC output. But the observant viewers among you might have noticed these jumps. These jumps happen when we switch between the two current sense resistances. To explain why we do this, let's go back to the simplified circuit with just one current sense resistor. At the maximum current of 5.4 amps, the current sense voltage is 54 millivolts, which is perfectly fine. But for moonlight modes, for example, 1 lumen output, we need to set the current to approximately 1.4 milliamps. At this mode, the current sense voltage falls to approximately 14 microvolts, which is too low for us. One option is to increase the resistor value to 1 ohm, and the same low current results in a much more reasonable current sense voltage of 1.4 millivolts. But now, if we go back to the maximum current of 5.4 amps, the resistor has to dissipate 29 watts. In fact, it's not even possible for the circuit to reach this maximum output, because that requires 5.4 volt inputs into the op amp, which far exceeds our LDO output voltage. So in summary, we want to use the 1 ohm resistor in the low current mode, but we want the 10 milliohm resistor for the high current mode. Fortunately, we can have both by using a MOSFET to switch between the two current sense resistances. Note that the other current sense resistor is only 5 milliohms instead of 10 milliohms. That's because the MOSFET switching it contributes the other 5 milliohms, roughly. However, for the MOSFET to have a consistent on resistance, we need to drive its gate properly. Let's have a look at the datasheet. There's a diagram that shows us how the MOSFET's resistance varies with the current, and more importantly, VGS, which is the voltage between the gate and source. Since the source is ground, VGS is just the gate drive voltage. If we were to drive the gate using our 2.5 volt GPIO from the microcontroller, the resistance will be in the upper region and vary significantly with the current. Since this resistance is part of our current sense resistance, we need it to vary as little as possible. What we can do instead is to drive the gate using the output from the boost converter, which is going to be approximately 6 volts. This causes the MOSFET's resistance to decrease and, more importantly, vary less with current. In this schematic, I've pulled the gate to the boost converter's output through a 10K resistor. The gate can then be driven low using another N-channel MOSFET. I actually made the mistake of using a P-channel MOSFET here in revision A of the dev board. And of course, it doesn't work. I'll let you figure out why, and leave your answer in the comments below. Anyway, because of that mistake, I had to make yet another hack in the previously immaculate PCBs that were sent to me by PCBWay. With that done, we can verify with the oscilloscope that the gate is being correctly driven to the boost driver's output voltage. We can now output a large range of brightnesses, from under 1 lumen to over 2,500 lumens, hence the name High Dynamic Range or HDR. So, how do we actually know when to switch HDR mode on and off? I thought it would be best to explain this using a plot. Let's focus on just one of the lines. This line tells us that with HDR mode off, a DAC value of 1 results in an LED current of approximately 0.2 milliamps. A DAC value of 255 results in approximately 55 milliamps, and so on. We're using the log scale because it better reflects how we perceive brightness. Now, if we switch HDR mode on, we can get a higher current output without changing anything else. There are actually a family of 8 lines in this plot because we also have the ability to configure the DAC's internal voltage reference. This means there might be several ways to achieve a given brightness value. One way to get rid of the duplicates is to always choose the lower internal voltage reference. This gives us a high brightness resolution, 1095 distinct brightness levels to be exact. However, to improve efficiency, we should switch to HDR mode as soon as possible, since that reduces power loss in the current sense resistor. Using this strategy, we sacrifice the resolution, leaving us with 652 brightness levels. If you'd like to have a look at how these plots are generated, check out the Python script on GitHub. The same script outputs a lookup table, which we then copy to the firmware. For any desired brightness level, the firmware is then able to retrieve the DAC and HDR mode configurations, as well as calculate the nearest DAC value. The result is smooth brightness ramping from off to maximum brightness. If you're enjoying the video so far, please consider subscribing. Now, let's talk about startup flash. It's a problem with boost drivers that's known within the community. Essentially, when the boost driver is powering up into a very low brightness mode, the LED gives off a flash before settling into the desired brightness. We can see it a little better if we slow it down. Looking at the oscilloscope capture, there's an obvious LED voltage spike which corresponds with the flash. FB voltage refers to the voltage on the boost converter's FB pin. FB stands for feedback, and this is the voltage that controls the boost converter's output. For more information, check out the previous video where we explain how the boost converter is configured. Theoretically, we want the FB voltage to be greater than 1 volt at startup in order to force the boost converter to lower its output voltage, preventing the flash. One way to do this is to drive the op-amp's output to its maximum, which would then drive the boost converter's output to the minimum. This is implemented by using an N-channel MOSFET to pull the op-amp's inverting input to ground. I've also tried doing the same thing using a GPIO pin instead of a MOSFET, but that didn't work. I haven't figured out why, so let me know in the comments if you have. Anyway, with this implemented, the startup flash no longer happens, and the LED voltage spike all but disappears. However, comparing the two oscilloscope captures, there doesn't seem to be a difference in the FB voltage, so that's another thing I haven't figured out. Let's move on to something I have figured out, which is the ability to switch modes by powering the driver off and back on. When I'm flipping the switch in this demo, the entire driver is powered down. But if I switch it back on quickly enough, the driver knows how much time it spent powered down and switches modes accordingly. Since the driver is completely powered down, we can't have been using one of the microcontroller's internal timers. Instead, we implement a rudimentary timer using a resistor and a capacitor, forming an RC circuit. This RC circuit is connected directly to the microcontroller, which charges the capacitor during operation and measures the capacitor's voltage on startup. Since we know the values of our resistor and capacitor, we can calculate the time required for the capacitor to discharge to a certain value. Sounds great in theory. Let's see what happens in real life. The capacitor isn't discharging smoothly like we thought it would, and there are these huge kinks and drops. It took me a bit to figure this out, but this is actually caused by the microcontroller's pin protection diodes, which are meant to clamp the pin's voltage between ground and the supply voltage. In our case, flipping the switch causes the supply voltage to fall, and since our capacitor is connected to a microcontroller's pin, it too is clamped to the falling supply voltage. That's why we see the strange discharge curve. Fortunately, the protection diodes aren't ideal. That means they have non-zero forward voltages, which we can measure from the oscilloscope capture to be approximately 400 millivolts. Because of this, when the supply voltage hits 0 volts, our capacitor is still left with about 400 millivolts and begins its normal discharge curve from there. Fortunately, we don't need this timer to be accurate at all. An error of a few hundred milliseconds isn't really going to make a difference, so I've simply modified the calculation in firmware, and we're good to go. Now, let's have a look at temperature sensing. The LED puts out a lot of heat in high brightness modes, and we'll almost definitely be using a lithium cell, so it goes without saying a temperature limit is needed for safety. For this, we're using an NTC thermistor, and there's nothing special about it. We use the ADC to perform a ratiometric measurement, do some calculations, and we get the temperature. However, there's one interesting thing to mention. The ATtiny1616 actually has a built-in temperature sensor. So naturally, I needed to find out whether the NTC thermistor is even necessary. Let's do a comparison. Running both temperature measurement methods concurrently, I heated up the dev board with a hot air gun to just over 70 degrees Celsius and let it cool down. Here's how the NTC thermistor compares with the ATtiny's built-in temperature sensor. Besides the lower resolution, the ATtiny's built-in temperature sensor is actually pretty comparable. Of course, the NTC thermistor can be placed anywhere, unlike the microcontroller, so it still isn't completely redundant. Let's move on to another safety feature, battery voltage sensing. Not the most exciting, but still an important feature, because lithium cells don't like being over-discharged. The lithium cell's datasheet might specify a discharge cutoff voltage, which doesn't mean that the cell stops discharging at that voltage. It means we risk damage discharging the cell past this voltage. The simplest way to measure the battery's voltage is to use a potential divider to lower it enough to measure using the microcontroller's ADC. However, implementing it this way, there'll be current leakage through the potential divider, which will reduce the battery life, especially if you're using an E-switch. The leakage current can be reduced by increasing the resistance, but we can't simply choose mega-ohm resistors, because a high input source impedance into the ADC will end up reducing the measurement accuracy. Instead, we implement a high side switch using complementary MOSFETs. When we need to measure the battery voltage, the microcontroller drives the N-channel MOSFET on, which in turn drives the P-channel MOSFET on. Conveniently, complementary MOSFET pairs are commonly available in a single package, which is what we're using. Now, some of you might be wondering, why not use a single N-channel MOSFET as a low side switch? Well, I'll leave that as an exercise for you. We've now arrived at the final part of the circuit, the op-amp frequency compensation. The dev board includes footprints for different methods of frequency compensation, but we'll only be using this one capacitor. Let's first have a look at what happens without frequency compensation. On the oscilloscope capture, the FB pin appears unstable. In fact, a high-pitched noise can be heard coming from the driver. I confess that I still don't really understand frequency compensation, so instead of calculating the capacitor value like I usually do, I ended up swapping the capacitor out several times to test a range of values, monitoring the changes using the oscilloscope. I eventually ended up with a 3.3 nanofarad capacitor that does a decent job of stabilizing the FB voltage. The LED output voltage still looks the same, but I don't hear any noise anymore, so that's good enough for me. That's it. We've covered the entire boost driver circuit. All the schematics, design files, and source code are available on GitHub. So feel free to have a look and drop me a comment if you have any questions. There's of course more videos to come, so thank you for watching and see you next time.